Welcome everybody. We are late, so I'm just starting the business immediately. Welcome to Ayurveda Biology second session in this conference. This is the topic very close to my heart, so I refrain from talking about it. So that all the speakers, we have four speakers and address from chair, and then we will have a panel discussion. So I welcome Julia ma'am to chair this session. Shall I introduce the first speaker and shall we start? How do you want to do it?
I just wanted to mention we actually have five talks, and so we request the speakers to really keep it to 15 minutes. I think we'll have a timer here, so be mindful so we can have some talk afterwards. So get your main points there.
And yeah. So because the panel discussion is at the end, so that we grasp everything from all the talks and then collate it, and then we can ask the questions and have a discussion. Questions, comments, and suggestion and discussion. So we begin with Professor Nath's talk, and all of the speakers are very eminent people in their research field. So they have all got a lot of publications, awards. So main thing which I would be introducing is the research topic. So Professor Nath is head of the department zoology department here. Former head of the department of zoology in University of Pune. His main research is on stress biology, how and what is the molecular signature of the stress and behavioral and molecular signature. He looks at various, he has looked at various insect types starting from Drosophila to honeybees, I think, right, bees. And then from after his talk, we will decide how far we should keep our mobile when we sleep or when we sit. So welcome, Professor.
Start by thanking the organizer, especially Dr. Girish Tilu, who was instrumental to bring me here, and he convinced me that I have something I am eligible to deliver something in this august audience. So basically I'll be talking on the Drosophila and Chironomus. One is a conventional model system, all of you know Drosophila. And a Chironomus, maybe I have to introduce to you, to many of you, as a novel translational research models to study Ayurveda concepts. So it has been a long practice to use animal model for biological research and medicine, and also it was a necessity felt every time to ensure that the model system deliver the translatable scientific data. And so the one needs to be very, very careful in order to choose a model system. And when we come to the Ayurveda, and there's one thing, you know, I would like to tell you that it is the science of Ayurveda also believes in the cause and effect relationship. And so now there is a paradigm shift. If you look at the contemporary Ayurvedic research, that they are seriously considering to choose appropriate model system for investigating these karyakaran siddhanta, or what is meant by the cause and effect relationship of different formulations. So the one model system, which is a textbook material, everybody knows that we learn the grammar of genetics from this fruit fly. Commonly called fruit fly or Drosophila, and a unconventional model system. With this model system, I have spent almost 3 decades, and it was sort of a lesser known model system. Now, at least I know in India, me and my students who every day they struggle, you know, to work on the least popular model system. There are problems, but we got lots of information using the model system, and I would like to highlight that how this can also be used for Ayurveda research. So the conventional model system, if you glance through, you know, Cynorhabditis elegans, this is Arabidopsis from the plant, the mouse, everybody knows the zebrafish, the simplest eukaryotic model system, yeast, and of course the not to scale, you know, this is Drosophila. I purposely zoomed it because this is the focus of my talk. So this is generally called fruit fly, and if you go to any fruit market and all that, you will see that this is hovering around you, And almost in the beginning of the last century, Thomas Morgan, who has introduced Drosophila to biological research, and lots of seminal, publications, and then basically the science of genetics got enriched through Morgan's research. And there are many, many Nobel Prizes, but recent ones like the 1995, the Hox genes story, and all of you know about the Hoffman's Nobel Prize winning, the work in 2011, the direct link with the human diseases, immunity and so on using Drosophila, and 2 years ago, the period gene, which has again, they made a sensation, he's 5 decades work in the Jeffrey Hall started from Brandeis University and so on. So what I mean to what I just quickly go through it, that the Drosophila, the advantages are there are no ethical issues, which actually becomes a problem using the mouse model. That there are lots of the animal protection laws and all that. So you can use Drosophila without any ethical the barrier issues. Very easy to maintain, and the large numbers, genetic manipulation is very fast, and you have the lots of resources of this Drosophila. 5,000 mutants are available, and you can get the knockdown very easily, knockout easily, short generation time, fully sequenced annotated genome, and basic signaling pathways are same if you compare with the vertebrates. Low redundancy, non-pathogenic, they're so easy to handle in the classroom, teaching also. And those who are professionals in Drosophila, they know that the presence of balancer chromosome is very, very, helpful to, they maintain the mutant, even the lethal mutants in heterozygote stage, transgenes without genotyping. You can, there are visual markers you can easily identify. Now, actually, the direct, the link with the human. Biomedical research came after a seminal, report, actually summarized in the Nature Reviews long back 2005, that 75% of the human disease-causing genes are believed to have functional homologs in the feline. It was the in silico data, and later on, it came as a gospel truth. And everybody now, they started, working Drosophila and linking the human disease. These are some of the books that for your perusal. I have just kept it. And you can see the 19 years ago, 2000, the trends in genetics, there is a review, one can go back, the Drosophila cancer research, it was very prophetic, some statements it was made, and now it is used for lots of, cancer research, fundamentals, things and so on. And so you can see, go to internet, you will find lots of blogs and lots of sites, and it's called Homophila, they like Homo sapiens and Drosophila. So this group, they do translational research, and so this is just to make you sensitize that the global, the attention to Drosophila, to use it for biomedical research. Now let's come to the Ayurveda now. So this is all the introduction I have given for this. So now Drosophila as a model for Ayurveda research, some of the, the papers, in India, this is my alma mater, Professor Lakotia was my mentor, his lab, he started, sometime, 10 years back, and lots of formulations are tested using Drosophila melanogaster, and those protocols are becoming very standard protocol now for others to follow. And you can see the recent Nature the news, the Ayurveda gets the animal model, getting global attention. This is Drosophila melanogaster. And now there are two things I would like to, and of course outside India also there are human disease model Drosophila melanogaster. This lab is also, Dr. Nichols' lab is also working on this. Now I would like to bring your attention to this type of work where people are using the effect of environmental stressors, stress inducing agents, abiotic stressors, and which can lead to many chronic ailments, and whether Drosophila can be a good model to test the efficacy of many of the formulations. So basically they are called adaptogen, which helps to bring homeostasis under stress conditions. So, so there are a glimpse I want to give it to you, a small piece of work, you know, the on Drosophila, a collaboration with AYUSH COE in the our university and my lab. And so basically we work on different type of stress response. So one of the stress response which we have picked up for the last 10 years and it's paying dividend, and we are rewarded with lots of interesting data coming up using Drosophila as a model system, and this is the desiccation stress, that is, and which is also known as anhydrobiosis, that is life without water. So it was a, and then there are, you know, we are trying to link it with chronic dehydration element in human, where even if there is an intake of fluid, but it doesn't help you to reduce the symptom of dehydration, you know. So there is no permanent cure, but there's a symptomatic relief, you know, and then Ayurveda may play a role here. And so we worked with the Enya. All of you know it's ashwagandha. I'm not going to details of it. It's this audience knows about it. But what we try to to link this with that it is also known to confer stress adaptability. However, its potential as an abiotic stress protectant has remained underexplored. So we started a project, and I just bring your notice to some of our earlier publications. It's one of the seminal, the paper came from our lab. It's Dr. Lina's work, who was it was her doctoral thesis work when she worked with me. That trehalose, it is a non-reducing sugar. Okay, it's a disaccharide, say alpha glucose, alpha glucose, and that is the principal sugar in the body fluid of the insects, all insects. So at the time of the water loss, this trehalose level goes up. And it is hygroscopic. It has, I'll take one. I may take 1 hour to tell all about say, the trehalose, and you can go to the internet and find out the detail. It's not the our lab has first discovered this, but in Drosophila, it was first time reported. But Drosophila, the name indicates, dros means dew, and phila means loving. So basically, it's a humidity loving, the fly or the insect. So nobody actually paid attention to what will happen if you just put it in the arid condition. We just did it because to put it stress, because we know if you go to the some stretch of Western Ghat, and where the global warming, you will see the lots of its effect on the Western Ghat. And generally I have a hobby and patience, wherever I go I kept take some bottles and these things, and the trap which you can, I take banana trap. So I collect Drosophila wherever I go, and so I found that the Drosophila, the population where I used to get in Western Ghat 10 years ago, it's not there. So I started finding exploring that why it is happening, and then I asked the student to just do a small work, and if it's a pilot study work, you can take it as a PhD work. And then she found out that those Drosophila, the trehalose levels are very high, which is reported in other plants. The plant, when they get dehydration, drought condition, trehalose goes up. So same thing we found out, and it took us it is one of the seminal paper. There are many people started asking. We also tried how last 20 years many people are trying with Drosophila desiccation stress, but how did you get the success? Because we tried with the larva. Because the Drosophila lay eggs in the fruit, ripening fruit, they lay eggs there. The larva actually the first developmental stage which encounter this day. People worked with the adults and they didn't find the results. So we are lucky. Sometimes you have to be a little wise. And so this is a cover picture of another publication where you can see that when there's a 95% of the water loss, you can see there's a shrunken larva. And then if you sprinkle water, it comes to revive. And it's very amazing, and that's our essay. If it doesn't revive, that is, it's a lethal. That's the threshold. So time is important. How long it can tolerate dehydration? And so basically, Drosophila said, just remember this number: 10 hours in the lab condition. Okay. And then I'll go to the next slide. And so basically, we thought that we target this trehalose metabolic pathway, because if the trehalose is up, so it helps the Drosophila to adapt to the dehydration condition. And this is the it's a long story. It's 3 hours she spent, 3 years she spent to, you know, the dissect this biochemical pathway. And then finally, this rate limiting step, the trihalose 6-phosphate synthase is the first step. In order, you get this this trihalose 6-phosphate, and then you get trihalose. And when the enough trihalose is there, it is degraded by trihalase and is released. So this is a very important step. So if there is an enzyme, there will be the genes for it. So we look for it. There are no mutants. And then we decided that okay, we'll downregulate this key enzyme, because if you knock out, huh? Oh, 3 minutes. Oh, I'm so sorry. Oh, okay, so I have 3 minutes. All right, I'll just. So okay, maybe I'll just skip one of the model system. I'll just skip it. So basically, what we have done, we have just, you know, the made a Drosophila, you know, the which is the trihalose synthesis is downregulated, and so you just follow this these histograms. Now this trihalose deficient flies, if you feed the Vedania, the Vashagandha, like, you know, then can you see that the tolerance limit has gone up? So this is a very preliminary result. This is actually done by the Prachi, and the Lena was there. And then the potential of the Drosophila for other work, I just, you know, the end with this, that the bhasmas, you know, which is actually projected, or maybe there is a hype in the press, there is a nano medicine of the ancient times. So in the Ayurveda, there are lots of herbal mineral preparations are there. Ayurvedic bhasmas are there, which is least export. So one of our studies, which was published in Metalomics, where we have used a macro micro particle of silver, which is 10 micron to 15 micron, like, you know, the powder, and then it can remove all the pigments. Can you see that? It's called leucicism. So there's a pigments are totally lost by, you know, the, so it acts on the dopamine melanin pathway. And so I am proposing that, okay, I mean, anyone of you can start this work. There's like Ayurvedic medicine, which is known as a Rajat Bhasma. It's like in the silver, you know, the microparticle. And can this be, you know, the use again, relook into it with the Ayurvedic formulations? So thus, carinoma, the last, you know, I have 2 minutes or 1 minute?
None.
So this is a carinomas model system, and one important aspect of the model system is it has a hemoglobin, which is a monomer, unlike our hemoglobin, which is a tetramer, alpha, alpha, beta, beta. So it is extracellular because it floats in the body fluid. So just 2 seconds. So we have used a different type of, you know, the nutrient medium, and we call it, you know, the anemic larva. Can you see that the hemoglobin content is less? So my proposition is, we have a method we have developed, and then which is a hemoglobin can be assayed. So the question is, can carinomas be used as a potential animal model for Ayurvedic research on the Rakta Dhatu? And so this is what I want to propose, that this is another model system which can be explored. And this is my group, some of them are here. Okay. Thank you very much. And thank you for allowing that 1 minute extra. I know, because problem is you, the model system you are passionate about, you tend to speak more.
So thank you very much, Professor Nath, and I welcome Vani sir next. So now from the animals we are going to cells, and we are looking at the bone cells and models for bone health, where we can model bone health and how we can, I think there is a lot of scope of again transdisciplinary research, and that's why these model systems we are trying to understand more about. So over to you, Vanessa, and he's from NCCS, very this organization, and looking at the cell line cell biology work, cell biology of bone cells, osteos.
Good afternoon, everybody, and I would like to thank organizer for giving me opportunity to talk about the different models we use for bone and cartilage research. So basically, my lab works in the area of pathophysiology of bone and cartilage remodeling, and we also work on the stem cell, particularly mesenchymal stem cell and regenerative medicine. So today I am not giving any research talk, I am going to tell what are the different in vitro and in vivo models we are using for the bone and the cartilage research. So before understanding the models, you should understand what is the physiology of bone remodeling. So as you know that bone homeostasis is maintained by two important cell types. One is osteoclast, which resorbs the bone, and another for is osteoblasts which form the bone. So, this bone resorption and bone formation is a continuous cycle throughout the life to maintain the bone homeostasis. So, these two cell types have different origin. Osteoblasts, they differentiate from the mesenchymal stem cell, right? Osteoclasts, they differentiate from the hematopoietic stem cell. These are the different stages of osteoclast and osteoblast differentiation, and many transition factors and the growth factors play important role for their from precursors to mature cell formation. Now, how this bone remodeling cycle is regulated? So, it is a mechanism of bone remodeling. So, first step is resorption, where this multinuclear osteoclast, they resorb the bone, they secrete the enzymes and acids which solubilize the bone matrix, and then actually they remove the old bone, because you need a remodeling, removal of the old bone, formation of the new bone. If this does not happen, your bones will become very old soon, fragile, prone to the fracture. So, this is essential. So, these osteoclasts will remove the old bone, then the nearby osteoblast precursors, they migrate at the site of this resorption pits, they synthesize the new bone matrix which gets mineralized, then there is a resting stage, and again when the bone gets some stimulation, the another bone surface will be activated by the osteoclast. So, why it is important to study this bone physiology in vitro and in vivo? So, in this important diseases such as osteoporosis, rheumatoid arthritis, osteoarthritis, bone metastasis of breast and prostate cancer and multiple myeloma, you will see the number of osteoclasts is increased, their survival is increased, because osteoclasts, there is no DNA synthesis in osteoclasts, they are formed by the fusion of the mononuclear cell. I will show in the next slide. So, generally, these osteoclasts survive in vitro for 8 days time, but in these diseases, this osteoclast survive for more time. That is why then you get a more cycles of the bone resorption, so more bone loss, which is not compensated by the bone formation. Also, osteoclasts get activated, and there is increased production of several pro-inflammatory cytokines such as IL-1 alpha, TNF alpha, prostaglandin E2, TGF beta. So, there is a synergistic action of all these pro-inflammatory cytokines with the osteoclast, and then you get the massive bone loss. So, this is the microarchitecture deterioration of the bone loss. This is the structure of the normal bone, and this is the osteoporotic bone. Here you can see there is a loss of bone, bone has become fragile. So, we can grow this osteoclast in vitro. You take the bone marrow monocytes and then incubate with factor MCSF and Rankine, and then you will get the formation of this multinuclear osteoclasts, which are very beautiful cells, and actually you can count the number of nuclei. The cell is called osteoclast if the cell has 3 or more nuclei, and generally 3 to 20 nuclei are common in osteoclast. And whenever you get the disease like osteoporosis, sometimes you may get 100 nuclei in one osteoclast. So, you can imagine huge osteoclast, huge bone resorption, okay, huge bone loss. So, when the osteoclast resorbs the bone, you can, if you stain that, you can get the beautiful ring. These osteoclasts are highly motile cells. This is a scanning electron microscopy of osteoclasts. They resorb the bone at one site and they go move on to another place. So, here you can see the resorption trail. These are the resorption pits which you can detect by scanning electron microscopy, or you can also detect by the light microscopy. The another cell type is osteoblast. You can culture these osteoblasts for 14 to 21 days in vitro, and you can get the beautiful bone nodule formation in vitro. You stain those with a 1-COSA and ELISA's radicin, that will show that there is these bones are mineralized. So, this is again in vitro, you can check the effect of your different drugs. For this meeting, you can check the effect of different herbal drugs or acidic drugs in vitro. They should be water soluble, because the cells need the completely soluble factors. Then you can next assay is ectopic bone formation assay. Earlier I explained in vitro, now you can use the immunocompromised mice. nude and skin mice, and then you take some scaffold, 3D scaffold, you incubate the cells on the scaffold for 10 days in vitro, and then cell seeded this scaffold you can implant subcutaneously into the nude mice, and after 2 months you harvest. So, you will see that there is a bone formation in those scaffold, and that you can check by the histopathology and confocal staining. Here this I have shown because we had injected human mesenchymal stem cell in immunocompromised mice. So, you should expect that there is a synthesis of human osteocalcin. So, that is what we detected. So, it shows that the regeneration is by the transplanted cells. Then now comes to animal model, selection of animal model. There are different factors to choose the best animal model, right. So, hypothesis to be tested, usefulness is judged on how well it is. It will answer the specific questions, and most importantly how it mimics the human disease. Other factors are also important, quality of animals, animal care factors, physical and environmental factors, which should not affect your the readings. But the most important is how mimics your animal model to human, how many symptoms which are seen in human disease are seen in animal model. So, that is the most important criteria. So, osteoporosis, I will not go into detail, you know that osteoporosis is a systemic silent bone disorder. There are different types, primary and secondary osteoporosis, and this is more common in women after the postmenopause, when the ovaries stop functioning, there is a lack of estrogen, and estrogen increases number of osteoclasts and decreases the number of osteoblasts. That is why you get the bone loss in these diseases. So, you can develop this osteoporosis in mice or rat, you just remove both the ovaries, bilateral ovariectomy, and after 1 to 2 months you will get the bone loss. And this bone loss you can do by checking the different bone parameters such as trabecular thickness, trabecular number, trabecular, I will not go into this parameter, but this you can use micro computed tomography, which is a equipment which costs 3.5 crore rupees. We are getting one now in next 2 months time. So, you can check all these parameters in a mice. You do not need to sacrifice, you scan the mice and you will see how bone strong are your bone, with how much is the mechanical strength of the bone. Okay. So, these are the different parameters you can check with the machine. Okay, trabecular bone volume, connective density, and here you can, this is picture is important. So, this is a sham operated structure of the mouse bone, and this is the ovariectomy. Here you can see that after 1 month, when you remove both the ovary, you can see the bone loss. So, this you can use this in vivo animal model, and you can check the by histologically also there is a loss of the cancellous bone. And serum T terminal telopeptide type 1 collagen is a clinical marker of the bone dissolution, which you can study in a serum or even in a culture medium you can check it. Then osteoarthritis, I will not go into this, you know, all know that osteoarthritis, there is a both the means joints, there is a degeneration of the joint. Okay. Mostly knee and the hip joints are affected. And this is the cellular pathology, this is the normal structure where there is beautiful chondrocyte and subchondral bone. When you get the osteoporosis, you can see there is a degeneration of the chondrocyte, and also there is a overgrowth of the subchondral bone. That is why you get the bone spurs in the joint and you get the constant pain when you have the osteoarthritis. So, you can also develop the chondrocyte cultures from the human sample. So, generally we get the joint which are discarded after the knee replacement or hip replacement, and from the normal part of the cartilage you can develop the chondrocyte cultures in vitro, characterized by different gene specific expression by protein also at a protein level. So, this assay also you can use in vitro for testing the different Ayurvedic drugs. Then what is the model for human osteoarthritis? So, that was in vitro. In vivo also what you can do, you can cut this anterior cruciate ligament. Once you cut this ligament, the gap between the two bones is decreased and the bone rub on each other, and then you get the degeneration in 8 days time. Mice, you can develop osteoarthritis in 8 days time. So here you can see that this is the dermal structure, and here you can see the bone loss and histopathology, beautiful, very nice cartilage, and here you can see that there is a degeneration of the cartilage. And again, there are different factors which can you can measure by the microcomputer tomography to see how much is the damage. So generally small animals are used, and what is the lacunae in the animal, small animal, is they have small joint size, thin cartilage, chronic clinical symptoms you cannot study in this mice. Okay, although we are using this to test the mechanistic details of the new molecule and some preliminary finding whether this drugs is going to work, but most what is now the world is going using the large animal models. In USA now people are spending a lot of money using the large animal model, because what we use animal models is mostly inbred mice strains. Okay, so whatever effect you get in one mice you will get in other, but if you use outbred strain of mice or large animal models, because lifespan is 15 to 20 years and it mimics most of the human diseases and the cell pathology structurally and histologically. So the future is using large animal models. So what these animals are saying, you help us, because they also suffer from osteoarthritis. There is no treatment for dogs and horse, and so what they are saying, we use, you can try those drugs, it will help us, and ultimately it will help both, right? So this is the research. Now people are moving to the large animal model. The third and last model is the rheumatoid arthritis model. You know that rheumatoid arthritis is an autoimmune disease, okay, and several joints are affected simultaneously, and in this rheumatoid arthritis also bone and cartilage damage is there, in addition to several immunomodulatory regulators. So I will not go into detail of causes of rheumatoid arthritis. So this is the structure of the normal joint, and this is the structure of the osteoarthritis joint, and this is the rheumatoid arthritis, where you can see the swollen joint, inflammation of the synovial membrane and accumulation of several inflammatory cells in the joint. Histologically you can see the normal synovial lining in the normal individual, and it is 1 to 3 cell layer thick, but when you get the RA you can see that there is a 8 to 10 cell layer thick the synovial membrane. And what are the immunological parameters in this? In the rheumatoid arthritis, there is a lack of regulatory T cells, okay, which maintain your autoimmunity, and there is increased Th17 cells which are pro-inflammatory in nature. And see here again, this is the pathogenesis of rheumatoid arthritis. I will not go into detail, but here you can see there is an increased pro-inflammatory cytokine, decrease anti-inflammatory cytokines, and decreased Treg cells, IL-10 and TGF-beta. So what we are using is, we are using collagen-induced arthritis mouse model, which mimics the human. So on day 0, we inject collagen type 2 emulsified in complete fluorine adjuvant subcutaneously under the tail of the mice, and then we give the booster dose of this collagen 2 antigen again on day 21. And then from whatever drugs you want to test, you can give one day after the booster. So this will induce the rheumatoid arthritis, and then you can sacrifice the mice, do the all analysis by flow cytometry, you can do the CBA for analyzing the different cytokine profile, micro CT for different parameters, histology, and soft X-ray. So this is the example how we have developed the rheumatoid arthritis. These are the different grade. This is normal, and here you can see that there is an inflammation and the paw thickness. Histologically you can see there is a damage of the bone and cartilage, and by X-ray also you can see. So here this is the control, and here you can see that there is a inflammation of the nearby soft tissue. So this is the way you can do, and you can also you can also develop the bone metastasis in mouse model by injecting the breast cancer cells or prostate cancer cells, which will metastasize to bone. So this model also we have developed. So we inject intratibially or intracardiac this any cancer cell breast cell line you inject into the mice, and then you will get the metastasis. Here you can see that the metastasis are developed in the mind. We have in vivo imaging system where you can label the cells and then check the where the cells are going to different organs where they are going to metastasis. This can also be possible by using the in vivo. Okay, and so these are the different for mechanistic details we can use different animals. But there are certain lacunae, as I mentioned, because of the shorter lifespan, you cannot do the long term studies, efficacy and safety studies. So, now there is the importance of large animal, which I have already mentioned. So, even for stem cell therapy, the mice models are not useful, because we cannot actually inject the sufficient amount of cells intravenously. It is very difficult to inject intravenously. So, now these large animals models will be useful to see the different challenges for the stem cell therapy in clinical, because we cannot actually use mice for long term study. The lifespan of mice is only 2 years. We want to know whether injected stem cell has any adverse effect over the 4 to 5 years time. So, that we cannot study in mice. So, you have to use the large animal model. Okay, so thank you very much. And I have not presented the research, but we are doing a lot of research in bone and cartilage biology. So, these are my alumni PhD students. They are working in different labs in USA, UK and India also. There are several medical and veterinary and students were also there in the lab. Okay, thank you very much. And
next speaker is Professor Rama Jayasundar, very, very transdisciplinary personality. And I think her, she doesn't need an introduction, because in many of our conferences, I have heard her, and I think most of you must have heard her. So, she works in AIMS and she will be talking about how we can use analytical techniques to understand concepts of Ayurveda. Over to you, Madam. Let me
begin quickly with, you have put the slide now, you have connected this. With getting some, refreshing our memories about some basic facts before I go on to the topic itself. So, all clinical medicine, whether it is Ayurveda or allopathy or homeopathy, they begin with the diagnosis and end with treatment. The entire research for any clinical medicine, they deal with these two factors: diagnosis, how to improve the diagnosis, how to improve the treatment. While diagnosis defines treatment, how the human system is conceptualized and understood will define diagnosis. If the human system is understood in terms of molecules and genes and proteins and cells and organs, you will see that the same language is spoken in diagnosis as well. Now, I don't want this facing me. I will finish in time. It's distracting. That's why I stood here. So, why would a particular system look at the human system in the way it's looking at? So, let's remember that a human system is a very complex biological system. There will be more than one way to look at it, right? So, we also know that clinical medicine, just like engineering, is an applied science. There are contributing fundamental sciences, and the world view, or the way that fundamental science looks at the physical reality, is what is going to define how the human system is going to be understood. So, understanding of reality, or in other words, worldview, this is where the difference between different clinical medicines begin. Now, let's see the worldview and impact, and its impact on modern medicine. The worldview of classical physics, which says that reality is made of material objects which can be reduced to smaller ones, is reflected in the way that all modern disciplines have taken off. You see the structural reductionism. How this here, the larger object is the entire human organism. It is reduced to the level of molecule. We know that modern medicine is also called molecular medicine. Now, let's see how the worldview, what kind of worldview Ayurveda has adopted. It has obviously adopted the Vedic worldview, which says that reality exists as a continuum with interconnected and inseparable entities in a dynamic relationship. And how has it affected the way the human system is conceptualized? So, the entire human system is looked upon like a functional holism. It is a seamless entity. There are no demarcations. So, there are four domains. There is a physical domain, there is a physiological, psychological, and a domain of consciousness. While each domain is interconnected. There are parameters mentioned in Ayurveda to connect these domains. There is also interconnection. You can see these areas of overlap. So, the entire human system is one seamless entity. This is how Ayurveda has conceptualized the human system. There are handful of classifications of human system by Ayurveda, but the one which runs as an undercurrent to the entire understanding and handling of health and disease is based on doshas, which are called vata, pitta and kapha. So, this is a functional classification. Ayurveda has identified three major functions in the body: movement, metabolism and growth, and in the context of Ayurveda these are called vata, pitta and kapha. And so, V, P and K encompass the entire psychophysiological functions. Ayurveda does not delink mind and body, it is always considered as one cohesive unit. And what makes it a pragmatic clinical system is the second point here, that VPK, they are characterized by biophysical, chemical, physiological and psychological parameters. And the beauty of this is that these are all interconnected parameters. So, there is a specific purpose as to why each of these analytical techniques, which abound in number, they are developed. All of them, in fact, they look at structures either at the gross level or at the subtle level, or functions associated with the structures. Now, if we want to use the same analytical techniques for Ayurveda, which has a very different conceptualization and a very different set of parameters, metrics to measure health and disease, and if we want to use the same analytical techniques, some thought has to go into this. We cannot simply blindly use it. So, with that basic information, let me go on to this technique, analytical technique of nuclear magnetic resonance, which is one of my core expertise, and how I have used or I continue to use this to look into various aspects of Ayurveda. So, nuclear magnetic resonance is called NMR, or it is also known as MR. It has two branches. One is magnetic resonance imaging. I am sure most of you would have heard of this. This gives structural information like this. This is the axial section of brain, and there is also a magnetic resonance spectroscopy, which gives you biochemical information. Now, this is the snapshot of my MR studies. So, I look at the therapeutic efficacy of Ayurvedic intervention in the context of stroke and osteoarthritis using clinical MR. I also look at the efficacy of yoga interventions in stroke. I will give some example of results from this study. Effects of mantra. Mantra is very much part of the kitty of Ayurvedic treatment. Body composition analysis for Prakriti using parameters that Ayurveda talks about for Prakriti. And MR for Ayurvedic biomarkers. So, Ayurveda uses biophysical properties, and I use MR to look into objectivize some of these biophysical properties Ayurveda talks about. I also do high resolution NMR of solutions for in Ayurvedic pharmacology, diet and nutrition. I study medicinal plants and nutraceutical plants and polyherbal formulations. So, I will give one example from a non-pharmacological intervention, how I have used MR, and another one as to how I have used MR to look at some concepts in Ayurveda. So, this is MR evaluation in stroke, where these patients were subjected to given yoga treatment as a post-stroke rehabilitation program. And you can see that this is the MR image, processed MR image showing the cortical thickness of gray matter. So, this is before yoga and this is post yoga, six months post yoga. Now, of course, if you look at these two images, you cannot really make anything out, but this picture, this one where this is subtracted from this, shows this area here in red, which indicates that there is a change, increase in the cortical thickness of gray matter in this particular area. And this is yoga induced functional MRI changes in stroke recovery. So, this is the pre-yoga images. You can see that there is no activation, and this is 6 months post yoga, and you can see this red patches shows that this part of the brain is actually participating in the motor activity with the patient was subjected to. Now, this you can actually quantify the extent to which the functionality has recovered. Now, this is an example of using NMR for Ayurvedic, studying the Ayurvedic concept, NMR phytometabolomics for Ayurvedic rasa based classification of medicinal plants. So I already told you all that, you know, VPK functions as a common platform for all factors which play a role in health and disease, and plants play a role not only in diet and nutrition but also for medicines. And so how are these substances classified in terms of VPK? It is through these intervening set of parameters which are mentioned as rasa in Ayurveda and literally translated as taste. So all physical substances in the universe are classified under these categories. It can have a single rasa or a combination up to five, and these in turn are understood in terms of the physiological and functional changes that they would cause in the system. So Ayurvedic pharmacological parameters or major parameters are what's called rasa, guna, virya, vipaka, and I have focused on this concept of rasa. And so this is a rasa based classification of medicinal plants from a single rasa category. You can see that there are plants which is grouped under these various taste groups. From a modern botany point of view, there is nothing common, but from an Ayurvedic point of view, there is a lot of commonality between these plants. And so my aim was to see if I can get a fingerprint of this classification of plants in Ayurveda. So this is an NMR spectra from four different taste categories. Sweet, white is vinifera, from sweet, piper longum, pungent, and bitter and astringent. You can see that there are some qualitative differences which I have shown by these highlighted areas. But when you put it through the multivariate analysis, which is a powerful statistical tool to look at fingerprints and patterns, you see that plants, NMR data from plants from sweet and astringent category, they show two different clusters. What this means is that there is something different between these groups of plants, but you can also see this area of overlap, which means that there is also something common. So here you see the NMR data from plants from pungent and bitter category. Again, you see the same clustering pattern. There is something different, but there is also area of overlap. And these two, between sweet and pungent and sweet and bitter categories, they show a lot of dispersion of data. And these circles were, you know, stubbornly drawn by my student, because this is what we wanted to see, some clustering. And then, but if you look at the data without these, you will see that there's a lot of dispersion. Now, in an effort to improve the clustering, I went back to this original information given in Ayurveda. So not all plants which come under the sweet category have the same property. So there is a further subclassification based on virya, which is potency, and then based on gunas. So what we had done is we had looked at these 24 plants, and the previous slide showed the data graph from the data from all these 24 plants. Now, giving the respect that Ayurveda deserves, we decided that we will believe what Ayurveda says, that this is different from this, there is something different. So when we redid the analysis, we were very surprised that from the sweet category alone, just based on gunas, there was a difference in the NMR data. So if you look at these two, it only means that this BP is the biophysical property. The guna between these two categories, groups, were the only parameter which was different. So when we redid the analysis, what looked like this looked like this. So this is a sweet, this is a subclassification within the sweet category, and then you see that the data from the bitter group of plants is quite well differentiated. You can see that in all the three. Now, this means two things. One is that Ayurveda stands vindicated in the kind of classification that it has done. And the second is the more important practical implication, that if there is an unknown plant, the Ayurvedic physicians will be able to at least group the plants into the right category, because there is no point in telling an Ayurvedic doctor that this plant has an anti-diabetic molecule or an anti-inflammatory molecule. They need to know what the rasa, guna, virya, vipaka is. So I acknowledge my postdoctoral fellows, PhD and MSc students, and the collaborators and the funding agencies from Ministry of AYUSH, DST, SCRV to ICMR. Thank you.
Our Next speaker is again very transdisciplinary personality. He is ex head of the department from chemistry, Pune University, Dr. Subhash Padhye sir, and he has varied interest in cancer biology, infective diseases, and lot more. So he would share his thought and research with us.
What I am going to talk about is something very exciting at the moment. Ayurvedic plants, how do they function? But one of the first thing that the Ayurvedician learns and has been described in many texts of the Ayurveda, that how did they find that a particular plant was useful and had medicinal property? What was surprising to us was the Vaidyas used to talk to the trees and the plants and ask them, what are you used for? And they said that they answered this question of the Vaidya and said, I have very particular for tuberculosis. I serve something for cancer. And we were amazed that if this is that you can talk to the plant and get the answer, you know, obviously we can talk to the instruments and get the answer of how this was done. It was a mind-boggling game for us to see and talk to the plant and what answers they give. We had to evolve a complete genealogical pathway. We have been successful now that plants do understand what they are supposed to do ultimately. But for each step takes 30,000 years. So if we have a compound in a plant which is useful for a certain disease, and we are, I am a cancer biologist, so particular cancer, then how did it take all these steps? Obvious question is, because the human mind is very cunning, that if I understand this, then I will be able to speculate what will be the next step and how that will be more powerful and more effective drug for that particular cancer. It actually happened. I am going to show you these two cases, one for pancreatic cancer and the other for colon cancer. We actually were able to judge that this is the last stage up to which the plant has progressed, and then what is the next step. So, and that compound turned out to be the most effective compound for these two cancers, for which we have patent. One is taken over by Novartis, so it will come in the clinic also. So let me show you a couple of slides on this. It's a major incurable disease. I don't have to, in sitting in NCCs, talk about cancer. Everybody knows, but just the figures that the how many new cases are there. It's a mind-boggling problem, and we need to solve this really in, to some extent. This is has been we have been hammered in the past few days or past few years. Integrated, you must work in an integrated manner with the medicine. Medicine has always been integrated. There are, we have only divided that is, this is Unani, this is Ayurveda, this is homeopathy, nothing. Final object is to help the patient overcome the disease. So this is just the definition. One of the major revolution that took place, that people discovered that why normal cells turn into cancerous, and this is through the transition, what we call as EMT transition, and they create the stem cells. What happens when you create the stem cells out of normal cells? This is just a description. I want to show you what happens. If you have a tumor, and in the tumor there are very few stem cells, very, very few. What happens, there are two characteristics for the stem cells. I'm going on a very simplistic manner, two characteristics. One is that it is completely nullifies any known chemotherapeutic drug. It doesn't allow it to act, number one. And number two, it always finds a place where to metastasize. These are the two important characteristics. That's why we are not able to cure cancer. So, pictorially, the current therapy. The red ones are the stem cells in the tumor. We give the current therapy, it kills everything else but the stem cells. And obviously, the what you get is back again the tumor cell. So, the drugs are acting, but they are not acting on the stem cell, but acting on the cells, you know, that are there in the tumor. And therefore, we have a tumor relapse. What we want is a drug which will act the other way. It will only kill the stem cells. It does not matter what it does with the tumor cells, but you can see there are no stem cells and therefore tumor is completely destroyed. Now, this is the thing that we have to see, what is the plant which will be able to do this. That is what the therapy we were looking for. So, we wanted to do, we studied the limitations of this anti-cancer drug formulations and so forth and so on. We did everything that is known in the pharmacology and in the medicinal chemistry. I want to show you the what is happens that the phytochemicals were our agents that we wanted to act upon these stem cells. And there have been cases reported which we normally as scientists do not believe, that you gave this herbal drug and the patient was cured. We do not. So, we say we will like to do that ourselves. You do it in front of us and we will see, then we will believe. So, phytochemicals, we were convinced that phytochemicals were really important. These are the finally going to give us the answer. So, we started studying this selected phytochemicals, and I am telling you, cancer is going to be cured in few years because of this study of these selected phytochemicals. 100%, there is no doubt in our mind, I will show you. But which privileged structure? Because phytochemicals have privileged structures, and a phytochemical which has the best privileged structure, privileged person also gets many advantages. You get extra security with you. You are late to the door that you are supposed to go. Everything is taken for it. You have to be privileged phytochemical. Just because you take a plant and say isolate the plant, as a chemist, I can isolate anything, but that is not a privilege. That is a trivial. So, plants have these two classes of phytochemical. One, privileged phytochemical, and which is no importance phytochemical. So, we had to look for this, and this is not what we are saying. This is the term was first used by Ben Evans by the Merck, and this is what it is, that small non-planar structures with robust conformation that provide interesting 3D exit vectors for substitution with drug-like properties. So, if we can get this, we can create a beautiful compound which will really kill the cancer. Okay. We looked at these phytochemicals. This has been a lifetime project for us. So, many all these compounds I am showing you have privileged structures. We got to get hold of these privileged structures. And two compounds whose examples I am going to show you, one obviously, one is curcumin. This is the one that is taken over by promised by Novartis, and the other one that we are working on at the moment, I do not know whether we have it here, but I will show you the data on that compound. This is from Aegilus marmelos plant, which is known in Ayurveda as bale. This is the best compound that can cure colon cancer. So, I will show you. So, missing link is the genealogical pathway. We believe the plant, we sow this bale plant, it grows and it forms a compound. No, 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 it does not happen that. What is in that bale plant has taken 180,000 years to form. So, let us do that. This is the genealogical pathway for the curcumin. How did curcumin form? And those of you who have little chemistry background, it started with phenol. This we got it from the archaeological samples. This is where it started. And then, And then it, what it did was it just had a hydroxyl group. In the bark of a plant species which we have identified, it just added a methoxy group. And you have a glycol. This is a wood lignin. Next step, it instead of, I mean, having only the, all this, it just added an allyl group. And the compound was eugenol. The plant was excited because eugenol had nice smell. After shave lotions is with the eugenol, or a nice flavor to the dish that you make with the eugenol, that smells nice. This is what it did. And plant plays just like a child, it also plays with several things, and it did. So when it started playing, that I can have a compound or produce a compound which is smelling nice, it produced 2-3 other variations. One of the variation it also played is, you can see, is making vanillin. All that it did, first it had added an allyl group. Now it just took off that allyl group and introduced a formyl group, and that was vanilla. So vanilla ice cream came from this evolution in this plant. But you know, curcumin doesn't smell like vanilla. So that's what I'm saying. It knows what is the task given to it. So at this point of time, it was told by the creator that, look, you were meant to go for anti-inflammation and you are trying to go into the smells. This is not your task. So it shuts down that genealogically, and then it takes you. So you can see it drops all these extra groups there, and it concentrates onto that original that it started with, a methoxy group here and the phenolic group there. I hope you are following that in it, for each of these steps it shows a different plant and a different organ in the plant. Here it was the roots. This is the apocynin, obviously. Next it went to form a gingerol. All that it had done here, it substitute this carbonyl hydroxyl group. And then it substituted exactly duplicate this on the other side of the central unit there, and you have the curcumin. How much time it took? It took 180,000 for each step, is not exactly, but between 30,000 and 40,000 years. So if we have to get a better compound than curcumin, 80,000 years, probably we will have, I don't know, 20 of our own generations, you know, we will have to go through, and then we will realize. The question was, now that we know that this has formed around 80,000, there must be a compound coming after curcumin which will be much more powerful than curcumin. And this is what we were obsessed with. Can we guess what is to come after curcumin? Because curcumin at the moment is active, does act on the cancer, but to limited extent. So this is what we were trying to do. So we did all this poor bioavailability. I mean, we have taken care of these things. The important thing I wanted to show you is here. So we did form the curcumin, and the formulated curcumin. Again, the property that it shows between the and compare this bioabilities of curcumin and the nano curcumin, because that point nano formulations were in picture, and we also wanted to show, it doesn't change the pattern. Curcumin degrades in the body after 2 hours. And therefore, that is one of the major limitations of curcumin, that it degrades fast. So question was, is plant going to create something which will not degrade so fast? Okay, let's go further. So as a medicinal chemist, we sat with the other organic chemists and said, where can we modify this curcumin? They told us these 3, 2 and one, six places where we can modify curcumin, and we did in our lab. So here is what we ended up with: 840 compounds of curcumin. This is a normal labor that a chemist has to do, and we did that, but tested 840 compounds, and we realized that we still hadn't obtained the result that we wanted, and that was the 841 compounds I want to show you is where we did. We realized that everything we had done without here, everything, but we had forgotten that something can be done here also. This was a period of 8 years for us to realize that that was the place which we had not substituted, and we did that. So you can see that we substituted various groups at this active methylene group and played with it, and we thought we could get a compound which was very selective for pancreas. Okay, let's go further. Here is the testing of this on this six organs with this, and you can clearly see that this compound which was with the substitution at active methylene group, we were able to get into pancreas, and it had a tremendous effect on pancreatic cancer. So this is again comparison of the curcumin and the CDF that we had made. It had such at the end of 2 hours, curcumin had destroyed, but this remains there for at least 12 hours, this compound. So that was the beauty of this compound. And then the question was, has plant decided to make a new compound, and has it made like this what we did? So again, I am showing you this. Yes, we got this compound made in 2008 and took a patent on that. In 2009, a compound was reported by other scientists in Phytotherapia. That compound was made exactly at the position where we had, except our substitution was different. Why? Because the plant did not realize that fluorine was the one, the group that had to be there if the compound had to be not degraded in a very short time. This is the compound, this is the bond that keeps the compound intact. So we did that. Yeah, sure. So then we play all the things that the medicinal chemist plays with, do the molecular modeling, and we showed the difference that the new compound touches the histidine, pulls it away from the central part of the target protein, that is MMP2 protein. And what this is a one slide that you should see, and I want to show you, we compared that with the compound that is normally used for pancreatic cancer, which is gemcitabine. And you can see with the treatment, gemcitabine at this concentration, still the stem cells remain, curcumin, still the stem cell remain. With the new compound, there is no stem cell. The same thing, we did it on four different things, and each case where we have used this new compound, there is a complete washout of the stem cells. So we did that on the animal model. It's the same thing, that you have the markers are gone, the size, the weight, and you can see what happens if you compare with the curcumin. The new compound is really, really very effective. Having done this, this was a success. We got the patent, and that was signed for the Novartis. Hopefully that gives us some money a little later, but initially we had a lot of money also. The second compound we took, and then So the second plant we played with, and successfully we got another compound, and I can show you. This plant is bael plant, Aegilus marmelos. It makes an active compound known as marmalin. Again, when we treated for a genealogical analysis, we found that it takes 240,000 years for it to evolve marmalin, which is the active Ayurvedic plant, and the principal component of that is marmalin. Again, we have to play with it, and we have now played, and this is a second patent we got from Bale. We played the same game with this, and this game was over and over played with these two groups. One, which is my own group here in the University of Pune, and now some of them are at different places also in the world. This is a group that I have. I have assignments in two. I work and teach in the US for 6 months, and I work, come back and would teach here for 6 months. So this is the two groups are playing with each other and do the complementary supplementation. This is a group at Kansas University Medical Center where I'm working in the cancer biology. So with this, now we have several compounds in front of them. If you have, don't tell anybody, tell me. Because we can work out this genealogical pathway and get the compound which will come after many years, but we will make it happen in next 6 months. So if you have a compound, if you are a knowledge of Ayurvedic medicine, do not talk to anybody, just talk to us. Thank you.
Now we will have chairs talk, and then we will have panel discussion.
What I've done is I'm just going to give a brief, hopefully brief, overview of some work that I did when I was working with the National Center for Complementary and Alternative Medicine several decade ago. I was very frustrated. I've done cell culture for 30 years, and I was very frustrated with the cell on plastic model and trying to put a compound on it. You kill the cell, that means you killed cancer. But I was very frustrated with that. So I developed a model that, we've seen that, that is more complex and more more things going on. And the point of this was when I was doing this, so some of it's graduate work, and then I carried it on for another 20 years. But the point is that these are bringing up different combinations of cells, matrix, and hormone, and immune system, and paracrine effects. All these are being put together to find a final answer. And the idea is that you could potentially use some of these models to begin to understand the different amazing mechanisms that are going on in all of the drugs that we want to learn about. Herbs. We're not looking at drugs. We're looking at herbs, right? So my focus was the whole environment. The cancer itself, one of these could be a little cancer cell that's starting to grow, but it is surrounded by the stroma here, and then, these are the glands of the cancer. That's a prostate. And what's important is this? I don't know. What's important is that the interactions between these two cell types that are part of the morphogenesis of life are also there in the adult. And the stroma itself, the green part, can actually suppress the epithelial cell, and it does that for many years. Okay, thank you. So it does that for many years until there's something happens that it doesn't suppress anymore, and then the cancer begins to go. So it's the regulation within that stromal cell that and the whole environment that is causing the cancer to remain quiet or begin to grow. So the cell signaling is important. One of my graduate project was to remodel endometrium. And if you put, put the endometrial, this is primary cells, this is not cancer. So just put the primary cells in the context of extracellular matrix, and you have the stromal cells on the other side. That's one way to do it. Another way to do it was to mix it all together inside the matrix. And it was fascinating to see that the stromal cells would actually reach out and, looks like they were just moving around the whole recombined lumen of the endometrial epithelium. So the quick overview I wanted to do is in a prostate project where we were looking at DHEA. This is DHEA stroma and
TGF-beta, the hypothesis meaning that inflammation induces increased steroid metabolism in reactive stroma. So the context was DHEA. DHEA is a pro-hormone to androgens and estrogens, and it's a really fascinating hormone in the fact that we're swimming in DHEA. The body is just, there's so much DHEA that, in fact, it kind of looks like this. This up here is, it decreases with time, and there's up to 1,000 times more than this little part right here is blown up here. So this is the androgens and estrogens, but DHEA is like 1,000 times more than the androgens. So what happens is in the local tissues, the DHEA is around, but we don't know quite exactly what all it does, but it's available for local tissues to metabolize for wound healing or needing hormones, or it's circulating in the brain. It's an important neurosteroid, and in all the other tissues. It is metabolized to androgens and estrogens. And what we were looking at is these pathways in the prostate and looking at the different factors of that pathway. And so we would take the same kind of idea of putting the epithelial cells together, matrigel and stromal cells, and have a model that we can begin to understand how the DHEA worked, and then also eventually to look at other botanicals that might be involved. So the bottom line is that there's two cell types. Remember, there's the epithelial cell and then there's the stromal cell that's regulating it. And if you take DHEA, this in monoculture, the green, you put DHEA in increasing amounts, and the green, it doesn't really go anywhere. When you add the stroma, then this is looking at PSA. Prostate cell makes PSA when it has androgen. So we're looking at increase of PSA. So when you have the stromal cells in the red, then we get even more PSA being produced almost to the control of androgen alone. So that's like in protein, and that's a representative of the RNA expression as well. So that was cool. Okay, the stromal cells are important. What's going on with the stromal cells? You put DHEA on the stromal cells, they metabolize it to testosterone. And what does that mean? Now we're going to take that whole steroid metabolism pathway and look inside the actual tissues of prostate. And we see that there are increased cytokines in early stages of cancer. We know that inflammation is one of the first parts of cancer, as well as many other diseases. So these inflammatory components, whoops, that's the wrong button. These inflammatory components are being expressed, and they are here. What we're going to find is that they're involved in this hormonal metabolism. So we're starting to add TGF-beta by the grace of being in a meeting at one point, and somebody said, did you ever try TGF-beta? I said, no, we tried it, and it, sure enough, it made a whole difference in the project. So here, now we have these cells by themselves in white, and DHEA doesn't do anything. DHEA with another cytokine, not too much. But DHEA by itself with this TGF-beta, not by itself. But once you put those stromal cells in there, then you get this increased amount of the PSA production, protein, RNA. Okay. And this is just to show that you knock out these enzymes, you knock out the PSA production. If you look at just one cycle of this whole pathway, then if you knock that out, then or if you just look at one component, this was androstenedione, it showed that this cells are really TGF-beta is inducing metabolism, DHEA, to this androstenedione and to the testosterone. So we're seeing that, just teasing out the mechanisms of what these stromal cells are doing. And this just shows that this happens in other prostate cells, but not in the epithelial cells. So the hypothesis is that DHEA is bathing the body's tissues in high levels, ready for immediate availability of estrogens or androgens, such as in wound healing. That's an important component of wound healing. And then this reactive prostate is seen as a wound and induces metabolism of DHEA for androgens and the PSA production. So you're saying, what the heck? I thought we were at this Ayurveda meeting, but I'm going to get there. So the whole model is important. So what we've done is been able to put together the hormone component, the immune component, and the paracrine component is the stroma and the epithelium are working together, but it's running through the stromal cells. So we need all of those. You can't just take one and find the same results. So now we're thinking, what is going to inhibit all of that? What possibly could we use to inhibit this androgen production? So we started looking at botanical compounds. This is red clover. And the components of red clover were shown to inhibit this TGF-beta production, went down here. Again, protein and RNA. And we were looking at some other compounds too, and we had this, we took it from that small cell to a 96-well plate assay, so we could look at a lot of compounds over a lot of time and a lot of doses. And when we did that, we could look at some phytoestrogens. Some of these are naringenins, which are part of citrus, and we found that those were able to inhibit this process. We further tested some other compounds. So this is just the model that you can see the effects of this inhibiting either the TGF-beta component or the endocrine component or the stromal component. So it's got multiple targets. And so this is a model that you could use for identifying the mechanisms, identifying botanical agents that are inhibiting cancer progression, trying to reduce the use of animals, being an androgen detector, it could be using for anabolic steroid detection. So the tissue microenvironment protocol, these herbs and rhizotomies, we don't know what the compounds are, we don't know what the mechanisms are, but they may incorporate multiple mechanisms, targets, pathways to be effective. And they may be working on the level of the tissue microenvironment. So we need some new models to be able to include multiple components of the microenvironment to tease out these issues. Research in Ayurveda can validate traditional concepts that may lead to development of new biomarkers and be developed to test new hypotheses. So, we don't really know what we're going to find. There's a whole new knowledge to be gained. So these are the people that worked with me, and that's in a nutshell. I got 5 minutes, so let's set up.
We have a very nice panel. We have people from Ayurveda background. We have biologists. We have people working in the transdisciplinary area. So till the time we make the arrangements, we'll see who are the panelists. We have Tanuja Nesari Madam from All India Institute of Ayurveda. And we have Dr. Rajendra Prasad from Annamalai University. And then we have Kishor Patwardhan sir from BHU. Then we have our very own, my senior colleague, Dr. Satish Rao from TDU. Then we have Dr. Subhash Padhye. And we have the chair. Who's here, and all three speakers of the session. So I invite all the panelists to the dais, and we can then start with the discussion.
First of all, are there any questions in the audience that would be okay in the back?
That all the view of the body in modern biology, she showed us that, and she said, look, all these bioassays have been developed to look at propositions or look at change happening in that kind of a view of the body. But the Ayurvedic view of the functioning of the body is very different. So my question is, what are the challenges of the kind of, and now this last presentation on the micro environment, and so what are the challenges for new kinds of biomarkers that need to be developed in order to really understand or interpret you know, biological change as understood in Ayurveda.
Talk of research in Ayurveda, there has to be clarity of thought as to why we want to do what we want to do. Do we want research, Ayurveda, to be used in the healthcare to treat patients, or do we want Ayurveda to be used as an information storehouse to give the paradigm shift that modern medicine is looking for, or do we want to showcase Ayurveda as a science and provide the evidence that the people from other disciplines and skeptics are asking for? The methodology that has to be used will depend upon what these objectives are. So we need to have clarity of thought at that level. Of course, my focus of research is in the first one, that how do we use Ayurveda to be part of the healthcare? And what kind of research would be required that will help the Ayurvedic clinicians when they sit in the clinic and treat the patients? So the kind of biomarkers that I have been working for is the biophysical biomarkers, because Ayurveda talks extensively of biophysical properties. The many of the gunas that Ayurveda talks about, both in the concept as well as in medicinal plants, and also the other metrics that are used, talks of predominantly biophysical properties. So assays for measuring not the gene or molecule which will cause the biophysical changes, but the end product of it. So if there are bio assays which I'm pretty confident that I'll be able to deliver, if not immediately, a few years down the line, that would give the metrics that's defined in Ayurveda, and you can use the metrics that Ayurveda talks about to understand it and also validate it in its own terms.
Actually, I'm the biochemist doing a lot of phytochemicals by using the experimental models. So in terms of the biomarkers, suppose what we are looking for Ayurvedic medications means, we may use the experimental models in case of the tumor xenograft, like that animals we can able to use. So the anti-cancer formulations we can able to treat to the animals. After that, if the tumor regression is there, if it is actually cured, means we can able to take the tissues from the control as well as the treated animals, and we can go for proteomics like kind of analysis. So what are the proteins that is differentially expressed between these two that we can able to identify by the LCMS or multi-TOF methodology? Then this kind of markers might be the target for that particular the formulations what we are having. So we can able to do more analysis on that particular proteins for against this kind of formulations. So that could be my point of answers.
Different parts of the same plant would have different kinds of properties possibly. So what was it that was taken into account to the NMR studies that you showed? And isn't that oversimplification of the hypothesis?
I won't say it's an oversimplification. It's a simplification in a way, because NMR is conventionally used for studying molecules, not for crude extracts which has hundreds of molecules. But that said, what I have been looking for is the fingerprint. The information, basic information, is taken from Ayurvedic texts. So where they classify different parts of the plant according to the rasas. So it could be that, one plant, it could be the leaf, the another plant, it could be the root. But as long as they are classified under the same chemosensory group, I have taken them. And so this is the beginning, and so I have really relied on the information given in Ayurveda. That said, there are also, I'm looking at the geographical variations, right? The results I showed are all from plants collected from Kerala. So we are also looking at, plants collected, the same set of plants and plant parts collected from different parts of the country, and whether they are showing the same, pattern, and what happens if you mix these. That is, you mix the leaf of, let's say, a neem taken from Kerala and that from Rajasthan, and then, because that's a ground reality, whether they still show the same pattern. It is interesting to note that NMR is actually showing similar pattern. I have used all kinds of analytical techniques. NMR is the one which showed the results, so I have shown that. So I have used LC-MS, FTIR, UV, laser-induced breakdown spectroscopy, AAS, whatever technique I can get my hands on. LC-MS has given very good fingerprint for plants coming under the sweet category. And probably, you know, these are groups, you know, which probably has carbohydrates and sugars in higher quantity, and that's why LC-MS is able to pick up. But I agree with you, it's not, you know, as simple as I have shown. I have been working on this for nearly 10 years. I have not yet published. I'm just trying to redo the experiments again and again to make sure that the pattern that I see is actually reproducible first in my own lab. So, but then the results are pretty interesting, and I think it will have a lot of implications for the Ayurvedic clinicians to have a tool which can at least classify the plants according to the major rasa category. Then, you know, you have other sub-classification as well. If you look at the detailed information given in Ayurveda for this classification, it's so detailed that I, as a experimentalist, would refuse to believe that they did not have a methodology. It's not a question of tasting and telling, because many of the plants that comes under the sweet category, if you taste, it doesn't taste sweet. You can say that it doesn't, it's not bitter, it's not pungent, it's not astringent. By elimination, you can say it comes under the sweet category. So it's not a question of simply tasting and telling. They must have had a very thorough methodology, which we have lost. But you know, we are all very lucky that there are so many sophisticated analytical tools, and we should be able to use them in a slightly unconventional way. And we should be able to strike gold, at least for Ayurveda.
After so many years, plants are destined to produce some molecules. So does this can happen with humans also? I mean, we produce so much of the things and excreta and so many things. And so many human waste, like human urine, they are also used for the medicinal purpose and like this. So can you?
The question is, as far as compound of medicinal value, is it produced by the plant in a very systematic way? That is what we are trying to prove. We believe that each plant that is used in Ayurveda with a particular property was supposed to produce that compound, but it has come up to a 3/4 of that plan. But there is still the plan to be met, and it is going on, except by using chemical technology, we can shorten that from 30,000 years to 3 years or 5 years.
My question is kind of out of curiosity and directly to Rama Jayasundar. It is very, I think it is a revolutionary statement you made, that NMR, how it can identify the rasa. My question is, rasa and guna, as per Ayurveda, are expressions of dravyas, which is substratum. We say that kshmambo agni kshmambo teja khava yoga nilavanila doyol bono kramal bhudal madhuradhi rasodbhava. So these tastes are expressions of dravya. The NMR, kind of a very sensitive instrument, should be able to go beyond rasa and guna and virya, and should understand the what are the dvandva, that is the two bhudas which forms a rasa. And this rasa, this bhudas also, from subtlest to the grossest form, it evolves. This evolution is what makes the universe so variant. So if this study can, this can, observation can beyond, go beyond rasa and go to the elementary level of rasa expression, it will make more sense to a vaidya or from a utility point of view, because rasas can even change because the substratum will change. That is why we have got the ecotypes and genotypes. The reason for ecotypes and genotypes is that dravya, which are becoming the rasas and other pharmacological activities of that dravya, are the expression of dravya. So can you just explain us whether is it possible to go beyond rasa, because rasa is non-existent as per Ayurveda. It's an expression of dravya. Dravyas are the Panchamahabhudas, which are the basis for all the formative features, from subtlest to the grossest form? That's my question.
I have been asked time and again whether, you know, it's possible to go beyond this and look into the Panchamahabhutas. So this is like, you know, I mean, we know that atoms are the fundamental entities, but then, you know, when you do NMR, you are looking at it at a slightly higher level where you are looking at the molecular structures, right? So the same way, you know, although Panchamahabhutas are the substratum, you know, the fundamental entities from an Ayurvedic perspective, these form, this technique will not be able to go down at that level. We can do a theoretical study, and then there are some clever experiments which can be done to see, to take inference from. But otherwise, you know, you can't directly study the Panchamahabhutas. So the dravyas are made of, just like, you know, molecules or and substances are made up of atoms, the dravyas from an Ayurvedic point of view, they are made of Panchamahabhutas. Whatever expression that dravya gives, like rasa is rasa and guna are expressions, right? We are studying those expressions. It is not that the NMR directly tells you that it is sweet or it is pungent, right? So, but it, you take an inference from it. So interestingly, when you do, so the studies I have done on NMR for these rasa based classification, it uses crude extracts. So it's not an isolated molecule. So the samples are prepared in the way that is mentioned in Ayurveda. Cold maceration, so there is no processing done. That is one of the advantage of NMR, no sample preparation is done. You don't change the chemical fabric of the sample at all. So the preparation is as per Ayurveda, it's based on aqueous solution only. And then you look at both primary metabolites and the secondary metabolites. So if from a modern point of view, you know, what has the medicinal property is only the secondary metabolite. Here we are looking at the entire primary and secondary metabolites. So if you, even a bitter plant has lot of molecules from sweet category. Lot of sugar peaks from sugars can be seen in a bitter molecule, in a bitter plant. But what makes it bitter is the combination of these various things. So this is something that's of great interest to me, and then, you know, I'm looking at it, but I do not know whether it will be possible to do some work directly on Panchamahabhutas.
A quick question, Utkarsh Ghate here. Dr. D. Vijay Kumar of CCMB through CSIR had obtained in 2005 a patent on HPLC technique, and he screened over hundreds of medicinal plants and prepared their fingerprints. If you have already made use of it, well and good. Otherwise, that could be referred to, because that may be low cost technique, easy to replicate. Thank you.
It's not the cost of the technique, it's the information that you get from it. That's what is important, what is going to be relevant in the context of Ayurveda. So HP is something that, you know, the sample structure, chemical fabric is broken to make the study, and it's not ideal from an Ayurvedic point of view.
Know that a particular molecule has not reached its maximum potential. When you say that, oh, curcumin has to still evolve, how do we deduce that? Maybe it's just like full potential. Just because it's not curing cancer does not mean that it's not in the job, you know.
How much time it spends in the body to exert its activity. I showed you curcumin, at the end of 2 hours, it's just gone. So same thing what we try to do. If we have to say that this compound is going to be very active, it has to stay in the system for a longer time.
From the Ayurveda perspective, I have not heard your lecture, but what you mentioned, I just would like to add here. It's a principle in Ayurveda, it is alpasya api mahartatvam prabhutasya alpakarmatam. So whatever is really not potent and the potential, there are many means and ways how we really potentiate that. Curcumin, for example, the curcumin you say, haridra, if it is taken with the milk, the lipid, then it becomes a potential. If you take as it is not. So it is not only a drug, it is not only a one pure compound phytoconstituent, it is an entire drug delivery that really gives the effects. That's what I wanted to say.
After going through all these discussions, I am a teacher of, I am a faculty from Ayurveda, and I am asking this when I look towards students or something like this. We heard all these important things, and these things are really fascinating. But as a faculty or a teacher from Ayurveda background, actually how we are planning to implement these things into our curriculum or to, you know, add on to our students, and what strategies we are planning or how we should look at it into as a faculty perspective.
I have been into the curriculum framing committees and on so on, and it has been very, very difficult to introduce even a single subheading like recent advances. It has been very difficult. I have fought like anything to introduce one sentence of recent advances. That is the mindset that we need to change. That is one thing. And moreover, what I wanted to speak about today's discussions that have been held over here is, most of them have concentrated on the intervention aspect, like medicinal plants and so on. But there is immense opportunity for us to investigate into physiology, behavioral patterns and psychological and sociological aspects of human beings using animal models or some other models, which we have been missing, because Ayurveda biology is not only about targeting the medicinal plants or interventions, but also it is about understanding physiology and human behavior. There have been several instances in Ayurvedic textbooks where some rasa is said to be related with some certain kind of human behavior or maybe some aggression. There are several such emotions which have been related with the several aspects, maybe rasa, maybe even seasonal aspects. There is immense amount of literature that we need to look at actually, and behavioral psychologists or behavioral models. There have been several good journals on human behavior and even animal behavior, but none of them has featured any of the Ayurvedic studies so far as I know. And actually that happens to be one of the areas that we need to look at seriously. And why we haven't been able to look at it is, again, as you said, it is education, right? Behavioral scientists, they don't know Ayurveda, and we do not know the behavioral sciences. So this interaction, unless this happens, like if we, our graduates are not allowed to get MSc and PhDs in those areas, and they do not get introduced to our science, this is not going to happen. So that interface we need to provide.
I have a question that typically to model systems which we are talking about. You said water soluble compounds and things like that, which is more useful. But we have, for such a thing like osteoporosis, where it is degenerative kind of a phenomena, we have a lot of Ayurvedic people use a lipid based, fat based thing. So I'm sure that if we talk more and discuss more, we can see how we can make use of these model systems which we have and the techniques, new techniques, and actually start checking the therapies as well as the concept. Because there is a concept why the fat medium is used. It's not just the practice. There is a concept why it is used. Why? What are the qualities of fat media? And which I think we can go to many deeper levels. Once the dialogue starts, this whole thing is because we want to start the dialogue. And that's why I said that, let's ask the questions, and I think we have one last comment, and then maximum one question we can take.
This is just information I would like to give from the government perspective. National Medicinal Plant Board, I'm working as a coincidentally CEO of National Medicinal Plant Board. What we have done, it's a diverse specialties which really look into medicinal plant activities, pharmacognosy and application. So what we have done, we have started an internship, 3 months internship. So different from Ayurveda, from pharmacognosy, from agriculture, from forestry, from phytochemistry, all of them, they will come there and they will have the knowledge of the other systems. What is the, so I think this sort of a interface, even Ayurveda biology, and there is an integrative medicine, Ministry of AYUSH and Niti Aayog, they are planning to have one school and one cell for the integrative medicine, and there Ayurveda biology will be major area where this sort of a starting from the electives and then internship, fellowship, PhDs and research programs will be initiated. And what we understand, last one comment is, first of all, if we understand our own science, because initially we really see other different sciences and will not understand our own science, and there would be more and more confusion. So if we first understand Tattva, Shastra and Vyavahar, concept of our own science from our own perspective, then we'll able to correlate and integrate with the other sciences, and then we understand the as a elective. That is the best way of understanding.
Background of Ayurveda as such, I am from bioinformatics background, but I have gone through Charak Samhita, and we see that the medicinal preparations which are administered are not mere plant parts or extracts from plants. There is a lot of processing that happens, and then there are mixtures of various plant parts with other ingredients, and the processing through different mediums, like, you know, there is water involved, there is involvement of alcohol, there is involvement of honey and ghee and milk and so on, as well as the medium through which the administration happens. So a lot of interactions do happen, you know, between the molecules which are present in individual plants which go into it, plants as well as those minerals and all that. So the final medicinal preparation, are there studies involving studies with NMR or other, you know, means for those final preparations which are administered to patients?
You know, again, NMR is one of the best technique to look at the whole formulation. So I work with classical formulations, which is the end product, the ones that are actually administered to the patients. And we have, you know, we can use it on cell lines. So we have done some work on HepG2 cancers, liver cancer cell lines, and administered the formulation as a whole, and taken it through the regular pharmacological assays. And, you know, we have compared it with paclitaxel. And, you know, the results are pretty astounding. And NMR can also be used for to get quick information about the phytochemical changes that undergo. So you do an NMR of, let's say, a liver cancer cell line. You treat the cell line with paclitaxel, which is a regular chemo agent. And you again run an NMR. You can see the lactate peaks reducing and a number of other changes. You treat the same cell line with the Ayurvedic formulation in toto. And you can look at the changes. If the changes are similar to the changes that you see with cells treated with paclitaxel, you just take it that the response is similar. So there are a lot of work that can be done, and that's also being done.
This is more a request to the speakers of today's session here, Dr. B B Nath, Dr. Mohan Wani, to publish or make SOPs of what animal models and cell culture models that you have done, and share it with other aspirants of this biology, Ayurveda biology, because that's going to be a very key starting point to address some interesting questions, marrying Ayurveda with modern science, etc., etc. But that will be the basis on which everything can be built. So if we can get started with that kind of an SOP, standard operating protocol. Yes, yes. As part of the proceedings of this conference, if we can bring that out, that would be really a very good starting point. And that will be the genesis of good collaborative.
Three, four things which we looked at, maybe if we can take how the integrative protocol can be developed by using insect models for stress related thing, the thought articles.
Right. That is one thing. The second thing is, I am a biomarkers background person, and if you have any questions with regard to biomarkers, their specificities, the sensitivity levels, please get my contact information from the organizers, and I am open to questions. I don't want to waste everybody's time for one person's questions, but we can always use questions offline and have these dialogues going on. I'm open to collaborations or answering plain questions, whatever it is.
Okay, I'll not take much time. What sir was saying, that SOPs, so all these in vitro models or in vivo models of different diseases, these all protocols are available on online or textbooks. No, the problem is when you are using this model, whether in vitro or in vivo model, for testing the different Ayurvedic drugs or compound. So the major difficulty is how to give these drugs to the, like, Drosophila, or because you, per human, you are giving it orally, right? So that may not be possible in all the models. So you have to devise the ways how to give these drugs so that you can actually identify how it works and then mechanistic detail. There is no point in going into fractionation and all those things. Just you have to see how best you can give this by different routes so that it will mimic the human condition. That is more important.
Suppose if it is the formulations, the mice and the rat model and the rabbit model may be the most appropriate one. So then we can even test its pharmacological activity along with its toxicological profiling. So suppose from the liver or kidney or brain, if it is having any kind of adverse effects, that also we can able to understand by histopathological analysis. So the animal models may be good for testing its pharmacological as well as toxicological profile.
Remark, and then we have gained 20 minutes. We started 40 minutes late.
Okay, well, I won't take much time. I just wanted to thank all the panelists and the speakers for. We wanted to thank you all, and that everyone should keep their minds open about ways to develop these models and to implement the models and to find new technologies and emerging mechanisms that might be involved in Ayurveda. There's a wealth of information that we're here to decide. So thank you again.
Yeah, we'll end the session with felicitation of all the panelists. So Dr. Julia Arnold, she will felicitate all the panelists. Rajendra Prasad, you can just, yeah. Tanuja, Nesari, madam. you can pick and give. Yeah, Padhye. Padhye, sir. Yeah. One more, Nath. Kishor, Patwardhan, sir. And then, Nath. Here. Yeah.